is a summary of results that we have been obtaining recently. I have to apologize, I have some problems with my screen, so that's why you see some words that will appear, some titles will appear somehow cut, but anyway. A gamma ray bus families, this is what I want to present you. First of all, I would like to recall the collaboration. We are many people working on this. This is a work we have been doing for many years, and we have involved a large number of people. And I'm very, very happy to show you here. This is one of the most important things I would like to mention here, is this important point of bringing together on this topic in astrophysics so many people working together, and with the aim of understanding better, bit by bit, these very interesting objects I would like to show you today. So we have here us, this is Rahim, observing from Italy, you one from China, National from China, and myself, I'm from Colombia, all of us working on the internet. We have many collaborators from many, many nations, so we have people from Argentina, from Brazil, from Colombia, from Croatia, we have people from Belarus, from Spain, from US, Brazil, and so on. So let's start. First of all, this is a parenthesis, okay, coming from yesterday, from the discussion at the end of Professor Ruffini's lecture, but I would like to show you a little bit more. So that was about that matter, so it's not the topic of today, but just to recall you, the discussion is what is going on at the center of the galaxy. Is there a black hole sitting there at the center of the galaxy, or is a concentration of dark matter particles? This was the discussion at the end of the lecture. What is a possible test? We see just coming now, this is the latest data from the Gravity collaboration. From the Gravity is an instrument at the VLT. The VLT telescope, the very large telescope in Chile, from the Southern Observatory, European Southern Observatory. And it is data showing that there is a cloud of gas, it's a cloud of gas moving near the galactic center. And from this, from the motion, they have been, tracing the trajectory of this cloud of gas for many years. So they have the velocity at the position bit by bit in the years of this cloud. And there is a claim that this cloud is not moving in a Keplerian motion. There is a small deviation from Keplerian motion. What does it mean? If you have a central potential, then you have the gravitational potential that goes as 1 over r. So you have very well, you know, what will be the trajectory that this would, how this cloud could behave. Near if the potential, if the gravitational potential is the one of the central black hole. Because this is at, this cloud is located at 1,000 Schwarzschild radii. So it's outside the black hole, so it should feel the potential of the black hole, but there are deviations, it's a deviation from this motion. And the discussion we have is that, see, they think that around the black hole there is some matter from a sort of accretion disk in the black hole. There is no evidence for that, but they assume that. And there is the deviation from the Keplerian motion, the gas and this matter for the ambient. This is the issue. What to show Professor yesterday mentioned yesterday was about this. Instead, what we're showing is that if you assume that the dark matter in the galaxies is composed of fermions, then what you will have from the mathematical solution of the equilibrium equations of the dark matter particles in the galaxy are profiles of this kind. The difference in the profile is the mass of the fermion. So for every mass of the fermion you choose, you will get a different configuration of equilibrium. So you could have something like this. This would be the galactic halo, where there are, you obtain the flat rotation curves, the flat rotation curve of the galaxy, as somewhere here in this position. So by explaining here that you have different behavior for different particle masses, different predictions toward the center of the galaxy. This was the concentration of that matter we were speaking yesterday. So, where is this cloud? This cloud is somewhere near this position, somewhere here. So what will happen? Instead of moving in the potential of a central potential, there will be a deviation because there is a distribution of matter. So this is what I'm showing here. What would be the gravitational force that this cloud would feel in this concentration of matter? So you can see right away the deviation from the Keplerian behavior that you should expect. What would happen? This is the Keplerian behavior. This is this green line. Is the profile, is the one given corresponding to 350 keV for the mass of the kernel. Is this configuration here, the black one here. So as the core, the concentration of core, is much smaller than the position of this.
Of this cloud, then you see that this concentration at this position, it creates a roughly central potential. Okay, and this is why this is the green line. What is the red one? Red is 48 keV, is this gray. So more or less, you see here, the core
for this concentration of particles is finishing more or less at that position. That's why it starts to bend, and more or less at 100,000 Schwarzschild radii, it starts to behave in a Keplerian way. Is this?
And then we have for
lower particle masses, you have different more extended force, and so the Keplerian behavior you should expect would be a larger. So this is what we were exactly mentioning yesterday. That exactly the solution about 50 keV is the one that shows you that should start to depart from Keplerian behavior of the trajectory at 1,000 Schwarzschild.
And I just took a picture of the black ball, when we have put the title of the paper which we sent to Mr. Mendel, and the title is on the basic committee.
The genetic motion of the cloud the genetic motion of the S2 star and the G2 cloud.
As
a test of fermionic dark matter. In our galaxy. Story here, because not only you have to show that there is the deviation from Keplerian just around here, but the deviation is the one that would deviate the trajectory as observed. This is the other thing. This was already I didn't show here that, but it was already.
Is
48. Would be around 48, which is the same as we used before, as the red one for the key for the explanation of the Milky Way.
Yes.
This one. Okay. So it was just to recall. Explain also the behavior of the nearest stars to the galactic center. These are the stars of the S cluster and these lines here. That they show a Keplerian motion because they are located somewhere here. Okay. So this I hope this now is more clear why is so important this result from this, and it's not trivial at all. So I think now I can start from the presentation. So I moved to a different topic. So the title was eight different families of gamma ray bars. So these gamma ray bars, yesterday the Professor Rufino already made an introduction of what a gamma ray bar is, these explosions, but Actually, they told me only in gamma rays. It was just at the beginning when they were discovered. Now we know that you're in the optical, in the infrared, ultraviolet, in the radio, in the X-rays, in all the electromagnetic spectrum.
And these are the most powerful explosions in the universe. So this is the topic we are studying, and the understanding we are reaching bit by bit of this is that these explosions, they don't come from a single progenitor, namely that these explosions actually they come from a variety of sources, of kind of sources. This is what we call families. So these gamma ray bursts show a light curve and a spectrum. By analyzing this light curve and spectrum, then we reach the conclusion that they are not all the same. They are different. And we were making groups, just grouping the features of this system. And now we are reaching this conclusion. And we can divide these groups into kinds of systems. The ones we call binary-driven hypernovae and binary mergers of compact objects. I will enter into detail now. These two kind of objects will form the 8 different families of gamma ray bursts. The important point here is that they are binary systems. This is the important point. We know that most mass are in binaries. They are in binary systems. So we could not actually, there was increasing evidence that these objects would have as progenitors binaries. So we could not avoid to make a model based on binary systems. Let's go bit by bit on that. What is this? This was like I decided to put this at the beginning, but actually this would be the end. So this is what we are reaching at the end. These are simulations, actually numerical simulations. These are not artistic. These are simulations from computers of this system. What is this? This was a supernova and a star exploding a supernova. And this star was in here, you see, exploding. And this is a neutron star companion. So this was a binary system. This explosion started to produce a very massive accretion process on this neutron star here. And you see there is accretion process for the vortices and so on. And this neutron star then by this accretion reached the maximum stable mass, then gravitational collapse, and the form of a black hole. And during this process, of course, this process is full of electromagnetic emission at any time. So this is a density profile. It's a density profile on the orbital plane, just to show you how this is the evolution of the matter, how it is distributed, and all this stuff. So this simulation, I'll get into the details of this. These kind of objects are the ones which explain some of the families of gamma ray bursts. And the other ones, this is only an example. This was, I'm sure, show you again. This is a white dwarf binary merger. So two white dwarf stars that are in coalescence. And bit by bit, they, by emitting gravitational waves, they orbit shrink all the way up to the merger, the final merger of the two stars. So we have, of this kind of compact object binary mergers, we have of different kinds. So not only a couple of white dwarf merging, but also a couple of neutron stars merging, neutron star and white dwarf merging. So these are all the other families and all the objects. Again, this is very rich of electromagnetic emission at any time in the process. And this is what we are trying to catch by the satellite, by the telescope. So at each time, there is a signal, maybe in gamma rays, in X-rays, typically in the optical. Then by simulations, you simulate what is happening, and then you compare with light curves, you compare with the spectra, and then you see if this is the corresponding one to one. Okay? This is the point here. These simulations I give here, the courtesy, I ask them to produce this video. Usually we do make videos in the paper showing the results of the more technical part. I ask them to produce the videos to show you here. So these videos actually were prepared for you. So Laura Becerra is
produce this. This simulation, this video for us today. This is a simulation at the supercomputer of Los Alamos. This was something like a 1 week preparation for the meeting. This one. And this was the courtesy by Pablo Loren at the University of Exeter that produced this simulation with the new code for this kind of members. So let's go into the details. So this already told you. So we have information from all the electromagnetic spectrum. This is one of the best examples we know of this is what we call multi-frequency astronomy. So information from a single from a source in different bands of the electromagnetic spectrum. And each kind of these emissions tells you something, gives you some information on this object. This is the famous Hubble Nebula. It is the regular explode star. So this was a famous supernova. So I think sort of finished from yesterday. This one, this picture here from the Hubble telescope, space telescope, which is in the visible, but we have information from this object in different bands. And actually what you see here, some of them give information of the remnant of the material expanding of the supernova, but some other, for example, if you see, you go to see in the X-rays and in the soft X-rays, hard X-rays, and now also in the gamma rays, so you can see even this structure at the center of the supernova that was is giving information on the neutron star that was born in the supernova explosion. So in the supernova, you have a star which becomes unstable, and its core of iron collapses by gravitation. And this collapse, the exterior material is expelled. So what you see here is the material which is expelled, the outer layers of the star. And at the center, a neutron star is formed. And this is the neutron star is what you are looking here. By conservation of angular momentum, and this will, touch this point in this presentation, because we are in our simulations looking at this process also. By angular momentum conservation, this star, the neutron star at the center of a supernova rotates very fast. I will enter now into a little bit more into the numbers. What means fast? Fast means something like a rotation period of the order of 1 millisecond. That is fast. That is really fast. Something like 1,000 laps per second of the star. So this is, and we are having now the source that Professor Ruffini was speaking yesterday of the prediction that made from here, and we're working together in parallel in doing the computation for that source of August of this year. Was actually one of the tests that we have made, actually the first test that we have made of the angular momentum conservation in our binaries, where we, from the orbital period and from tidal synchronization of the binary, we can predict the rotation period of the central star. And it was confirmed by the observation. This was one of the first very, very nice tests. That is the result that is being publishing as the scale movement right now. So there are different sources of energy in this system. This is, I put here an astrophysical system, sorry for the problems I have in the display. Several kind of type of energy that we have in astrophysics. In different kinds of systems, like energy, thermal energy, accretion energy, gravitational energy, rotational, electromagnetic energy, so from magnetic field process, everything. What's the issue? I separate here in systems. But what we are looking now is that in our systems, in our binaries, we have all of them all together. And this is the reason why at the beginning you see how many people in the collaboration. So different people, experts in different fields, trying to make all of us together put a piece into this thing. So let me go. So we have this is typical X-ray binary. This is just to give you a few numbers of the object. These are not our objects. These are all other kind of binaries, X-ray binaries. Actually, a previous evolutionary state of our system, because they have a cosmological evolution. Of course, these binaries. So This X-ray panel, they have luminosities of the order of 10 to the 32 to 35 Hz per second, and some times they make also
flare, they have flare activity of the order of 10 to the 38
per second. This is not very much, actually. We go to NOVI. These are, well, the biggest LV, this is an ordinary star accreting on a Newtonian star or a black hole. NOVI is a these instabilities that happens in a white dwarf star which is accreting from a companion, and then it creates a thermonuclear instability on the surface, and then this makes this a layer, the layer which is being accreted on the surface of the star to be expelled by this energy. And you see this shell expanding, this have luminosities of the order of 10 to the 34 per seconds, and when they usually in quiescence, and when there is the explosion of nova, they have up to 10 to the 40 per second. These are the NOVI. Kilonovi. This is not recently, but this is very important topic of now, and very recent and very revived topic, because actually this was you touched this point yesterday on the famous paper of Leon Pashinsky on the production of this kilonova. Kilonova, they work was on neutron star binary mergers. So in this kind of mergers, there is matter, the material which is unbound from the system, is expelled during the coalescence. So not all the material keep bound, but some material is expelled during this process. And this material which is expelled in this kind of system, in neutron star, they are composed by neutron-rich matter. When this neutron-rich matter is expelled, and then they start to combine and to be energy, they have some energy, then they start to produce heavy elements. So these heavy elements, they are produced by the so-called rapid neutron capture process, or as R process. How this R process is powers, is energized itself, the expansion of this material, and how by cooling, this material is energized, but then it becomes transparent, so it emits photons, it cools, and has a very typical emission in the optical band. You see, it's of the order of 10 to the 41 Hz per second. And this was very nicely predicted by Lee and Pashinsky. Now people make computer simulations of many computer acting at the same time, working, making simulations of this, and the result deviates not more than 5-10% from the result similarity of the machines. This is really what the multiple techniques I have in this kind of astrophysical systems. But we have now, and this is very, very new, that we published this year, is that this kind of emission in the optical is transient emission. It's transient, it lasts only 1 week or so, can also be produced in white dwarf binary mergers, as the one I showed you before in the simulation. So also in this kind of merger, there is matter which is expelled, and this matter now is not energized by production of heavy material, because white dwarfs are not composed of heavy material. They are composed of lighter material like carbon, oxygen. So they don't produce heavy elements. They are energized because in the merger, there is matter which is unbound and expelled, and there is matter that is kept bound. I will show you later. It's kept bound, and then by gravitational attraction, it goes into the center of this, create an accretion process onto the new object formed at the center of the merger. And this emits energy which energizes the material. And with this energy, it is expands and makes very similar process as the one of the arc, of the arc process. Very similar. And produce something like this. So these are kilonovae. These are the supernovae. So we are going in increasing energy. So that was 10 to the 41, 10 to the 42. This is 10 to the 49, 10 to the 51 F. Supernovae. So I introduced you already, this was an instability in a star. So the core collapse. iron collapse is the one that we are interested in, this kind of supernova with this kind of energy. And then we reach gamma ray bursts, the most powerful objects. So they emit up to 10 to the 54 isotropic energy. So 10 to the 54, this is roughly, this is in mass energy, this is like the mass of the sun. If the mass of the sun, mass energy is twice 10 to the 54. So it's like to emit a sun. This is, depending how you see this number, it can be dramatic or less dramatic. The issue here is that this amount of energy is emitted just in a few seconds. This is just, this is the that's why I say the most powerful. So this amount, high amount of energy in very few time, just few seconds they can meet. So they produce peak luminosities of the order up to 10 to the 52 Earth per second. And this is why we can see them on the way up to billion light years away. This is the reason why. They are so powerful that we can see them up to very large distances. So they have glycos like this. They look erratic glycos, very different, but very different in shorter, but this is exactly why we have families. They are not the same. They are divided in short and long, of course, because of the deviation. So this is just phenomenological division. It was phenomenological. Actually, it has some sense. It's shorter because this is duration less than 2 seconds, and the long the one larger than 2 seconds. But because of the large amount of energy involved, there is no, actually, this was probably the physics of gravitational collapse and black hole formation. This is old. This is old. Because what we know now in our family division is that not all GRBs produce black holes. Not all. Not in all of them. So this is actually, I have to update. And this is the largest distance observed, the GRB observed at the farthest distance at redshift. Let's go. This is a typical Lyco. This is a very, very historical object for us. This is the typical Lyco as we know now from many, when you have many satellites and telescopes acting together, then you get information starting from X-rays. This is actually composite Lyco. So this first information you have here comes in X-rays. So this is X-rays, a precursor in X-rays. Then this is a first peak, this is our gamma, these are gamma rays. And this is again X-rays. But you have also optical, this is an optical after, this is for something like 30 seconds, this is something like 100 seconds, and this goes like something like from 10 to the 4 seconds on, something like that. And then this is the optical information that you see. And you see here, this is in days. These are days, actually. And you see this bump here. This is nothing else but a supernova. So actually, these objects you see, and this was actually one of the mysteries of these objects, that you were something, looking at something emitting very, very high energy, gamma rays and X-rays of 10 to the 54, but you were also observing a supernova. But we knew that a supernova could not emit such amount of energy. So this was a mystery. But this is solved when you start to think that this could be a binary system. So that the information that you see is coming from different parts, from different phenomena occurring in this binary, in this interactive binary. So this is the supernova explosion. So this actually is for many years they have been called GRB supernova. So or GRB supernova connection. This kind of GRBs, this actually is a long GRB, of course, because it lasts more than 2 seconds. Okay, let's go ahead. So these are more or less what I said more to now. We have two mentioned scenarios. For the short GRBs, is that we introduced the mergers of compact objects. So it's supposed that they explain the short GRBs families. While the long GRBs, are embraced by this kind of supernova exploding in presence of a companion star. We have these two channels to explain all the variety of objects. These were the families up to early 2018. 7 different GRB families up to early beginning this year. What is that? Look at in-state, out-state. In-state is the progenitor system, how the system started. Something happened, they interact with all these environments. And then they produce something. It's a new object at the end. And this is the out state. And this was how we called them before. So there were these 7 families. These were long GRBs. This one. Producing by, this is a carbon-oxygen core. Carbon-oxygen core, they started exploding a supernova. So there were 2 kinds of systems in which the companion was a neutron star, or if the companion was an already formed black hole. It depends, of course, on the evolutionary path that the binary followed. It depends on the initial mass of the mass of stars. Then there were these, all these are the short ones. These are the short GRB, in which you have compact object binaries. So the 2 objects are compact stars. So the compact stars are usually, we call compact stars are white dwarfs and neutron stars. So you have mergers of new, 2 kind of mergers of neutron stars. The one in which you form a new neutron star, a new more massive from the merger, or the ones in which you form a black hole. Then you have a neutron star merging with a black hole. Of course, that forms a black hole. A neutron star merging with a white dwarf, it forms a neutron star. So this was the variety of mergers and binary-driven hypernovae and compact object binary mergers up to early 2000. They have these are observational properties. Peak energy in the gamma rays. This is the energy emitted in gamma rays. This is the isotropic energy in gamma rays. You see the numbers here with this property family. The energy emitted in the X-rays, the GB emission, this is important, and this is actually will be, this part will be explained by Rahim Moradi. The maximum cosmological threshold at which these objects have been observed, and this is all the very important quantity, the cosmological rate. So the current rate of these objects, and this is just a diagram showing all this. This is the evolutionary path. So you start from a massive binary. This is how these objects end. So you have this massive binary. Then you have the more massive stars evolve and make a supernova explosion. Then it forms at the center a neutron star. You have a neutron star, an ordinary star. This was like the X-ray binaries I showed you before. This is a previous stage of all final state. This is then evolves farther. It is losing mass, this star becomes more compact, like a carbon-oxygen core, and this is a progenitor. Neutron star and a carbon-oxygen core. This explodes a supernova again, so this system has passed 2 supernova explosions before our final state. And this is what we are simulating, and this is what are producing our gamma ray mass. This stage here. So what you see here are different possibilities of this kind of explosion. What defines the fate of this system? The mass of this star exploding. But we are reaching now the conclusion that actually this star looks, that is always roughly the same. Same mass, roughly. The initial mass of the neutron star companion, that could vary a little bit. But most important is the binary period, the distance between the 2 objects. This is the most important parameter in this system. Because it defines the strength of how big will be the accretion process on this object, mostly. so defines if this system, if this neutron star can or not become a black hole. And these different ones. Of course, there are different possibilities. So if this, the accretion process onto this object is not big enough, then you form a neutron star binary, because at the center of the supernova you form a new neutron star. And there was the neutron star companion, then you form a new neutron star. This neutron star binary will merge, and then you have two possibilities, that this form a black hole, or a form just a new massive, more massive neutron star. So you have all these possibilities. If this follows the other channel, that the binary period, so the separation is smaller, then there is a big accretion process, it forms a black hole, then you form a neutron star black hole binary. And for this, you form black hole. But if you remember, these are the families of our compact object binary mergers explaining the short GRBs. And these are the ones explaining the long GRBs. So what is very nice from this picture, actually, is that there is a cosmological, there is an evolutionary connection between the long GRBs and the short GRBs. Well, actually, the progenitors, these short GRBs, are coming from previous in time long GRBs. So this is very, very peculiar from our modeling of these systems. And this means that the rates of these objects are connected to the rate of these objects. And this is a nice topic that we are starting to explore now. So to make what we call in astrophysics population synthesis model. So population synthesis model is when you start to launch in your computer many, many binaries with many different initial conditions. So let's say you launch 100 kind of different initial conditions. And then, at the end, you apply the physics you know inside the code. And then the code starts to say, this binary follows this path, this binary follows this path, this binary goes here, this binary goes here. At the end, you count. From 100, I have 50 neutron star binaries, 20 neutron star black hole. This is population synthesis. So these are actually what we are starting now to study. But these are the interconnections, just to show you all the classes. You have the long and the short, and how they are connected. So how from these channels of long, you go and you start the channel of short. And this is the new. So we added an object, a kind of object, this year. So what we add now, and we didn't know before, is that actually this one, that white dwarf binary mergers could also produce a kind of gamma ray bursts. So this is the new from this year. This is why from 7, from early 2018, now we have 8. Actually, you come here, you see 9, but because we divide here, this maybe not necessary division, we are discussing this. So if you take these two together, this that become just 8 from the 7 before plus white dwarf binary mergers. That we make simulations, and actually from this kind of mergers we are explaining very interesting objects with emission in gamma rays, in X-rays, in the optical that I will show. So these are the 8 families, and we will go deeper yet. These are the binary mergers. So the ones, these are what we know in the galaxy. So I mentioned to you neutron star, neutron star, neutron star, white dwarf, white dwarf, white dwarf. This is what we know in the galaxy. This is actually updated. Okay, from the best system in which we know all parameters, so we know also binary parameters with high precision, and in which we have been tested also the emission of gravitational waves from the typical, from the full scale of computation at the beginning. Now we have many, many systems, not only neutron star binary, but also neutron star white dwarf. And also, very nicely, we have also a white dwarf binary merger in which the emission of gravitational waves have been tested, also from the decrease of the order, from the shrink of the order. So this is what we know in the galaxy. Neutron star white dwarf, well, you know, this is where just to numbers of the properties, but you know very well neutron stars are the highest density stars we know, with the densities larger than the nuclear density, so they have to have roughly like the whole object of a solar mass, but with a radius of only 10 kilometers or so. So with a very huge gravitational potential of the order of 0.1 c squared. And they are supported by a quantum pressure of the neutron mass, roughly. White dwarf, roughly also, they go more or less up to solar mass star, but they are less dense. The largest density is of the order of 10 to the 10 grams per cubic centimeter, so something like 10,000 less than the nuclear density. And so they have radii is something like 10,000 kilometers. And from 1,000 to 10,000 kilometers gravitational potential, they are less strong than 10 to minus 4 c squared. So, but they are, let's say, post-Newtonian objects in some way. So supported by electron degeneracy pressure instead. So this is just to show you the stability plane. Where are the white dwarfs? Where are the neutron stars? This is mass and solar mass, and this is logarithmic central density. So you see here all of the neutron stars in the nuclear density branch, higher nuclear density, higher density than nuclear, and this is less than 10 to the 10. You have nothing in between. And after neutron star, you have black holes. If there are no other stars exotic that we don't know, like quark stars, or habit stars, or something like that. Well, this is what we know from the masses of the double bar of the neutron stars. So this is updated. This is taken from the review of Ocean and Flavor in 2016. So there is a peak here. So the double neutron star, this information that we take from to study your system, because if you are interested in studying the mergers of this object, then you have to know which are the masses of this. So this double neutron stars peak, they have roughly 1.3 solar masses. So most have very close mass, each of them, the two stars. This is what we see here. This is M1 and M2 for the case of group 2 for neutron star binaries. M1 and M2, they are more or less both of them very close to 1.3 solar masses, both stars. So this is the total mass of the binary. This is the sum. You see, very almost a constant, because both of them have almost the same mass. Almost a constant mass. These are the systems we know in the galaxy. And this is interesting, because we divide these families in regards to the binary that form black holes, the binary that do not form black holes. And so this is important information, because when they merge, then you have to know, from these mergers, you can know which systems can form the black hole, which system can form the black hole, if you know the physics of neutron stars. If you don't know the physics of neutron stars, you cannot decide that. Then this mass is something like 2.64 solar masses. So this would define, actually, if you have a very binary merger like that, then you can say what's happening to that merger. It depends, again, always, energy and angular momentum. Conservation is always the side of happening in any physical system, and this is not the exception. So this is, again, you have to divide the mass. So the mass of this binary, the initial binary, goes one part goes in the new remnant, one part goes in bound matter, in kind of disk, if there is a disk or not. This is one of the key questions. And there is some matter rejected, but this has very few in solar masses. It's something like 10 to the minus 2, 10 to solar masses, the mass which is spent. So with respect to the total mass is nothing. Then, angular momentum conservation. So again, one part goes in the merger gravitational wave, one part goes to the central remnant, one part is stored in the material around, and so on and so forth. This is the kind of analysis that you have to do. Then you can, from physics of neutron star, I will not go into detail, but you can decide whether a disk or not can be formed system, from the initial system, from the initial binary. It depends on very, very, very precise information on the physics of neutron stars. So it depends on the equation, on the nuclear equation of the state of neutron stars, whether these systems can form or not this. and whether or not with four black holes. These are two key information that you can extract in principle. From this is a systems, this is a observational data, it's quite thing Rahim will speak about that. This is from the GRBs forming black hole, which they are, we show emission in the GEV energy band. The only one, in all division, if we look at the GRB and the short GRB, in principle, they do not form black holes, they don't show this kind of emission in GEV energy band. So this, but we really think that this is connected to the physics of the black hole. This is somehow connected to the process of energy extraction from a black hole. This is actually what we show from this very recent paper, this is this year, and we make some estimates of the possible mass of the black hole and the speed of the black hole in this kind of system from the analysis of the emission of this in the GEV energy band. And the same, something similar we do for in the case of non-GEV. This is a wider method, it is the same of we showed you before. So this is the kind, this is in another view. So it's not from the top, but now we are looking at the binary from the front. So you see one star going in front of the other. This is what exactly that we are seeing. They are approaching each other. This is the latest instant of this. What happened here? What we have shown is that in this system, you don't see here the emission, but we have shown that you emit from gamma rays with a peak energy equal to the 6 A per second, short emission of only 1 second, less than 1 second, typical energy. You see here the structure of a central remnant, and you see here sort of bound material, sort of disk that is formed around the new object. The new object in this system is a white dwarf, massive white dwarf. Then you see from gamma rays at the beginning from magnetospheric processes, because here the system, they have magnetic field, they have huge magnetic field. You have a new star here of one solar mass with a magnetic field of the order of 1 gigagauss or so. They produce from the material which is spent, which is not shown here, 10 to the 41 air per second at 1.5 days in the optical and in the infrared. And then you have X-rays from the central object and from the accretion onto this central object. So you have emission from gamma, infrared, optical, and then X-rays. This is what we show. This I show you already, so you can jump. This is the evolution of the central object. When it is accreting at the beginning, and then they start with the interaction between the central object, the disk, the magnetic field, the rotation, and everything. So you have the evolution of the magnetospheric frame, the evolution of the central wave frame, the central wave frame, and all this is shown here. This is the temperature density evolution inside the star. So you can check, for example, if this white dwarf, the white dwarf, I hope that you can, from double white dwarf merger, you can also, in principle, produce type 1A supernova. You can check from simulations that. Some of them will do it, some of them will not. And this is the merger will not emit type 1A supernova, the ones we are interested in. Because supernova A, that's another topic. Okay, so this is the region of instabilities of the white dwarf. The new white dwarf at the center, which crosses this line, will explode as type 1A supernova. So we are not interested in this kind of new object. We are interested in the object. And this we show them is the X-ray luminosity that they emit. These are data. See, this is the data. These black points that we from one of these objects. So we could feed, for example, X-ray luminosity from this new object, from the white dwarf, from the new white dwarf. This is a sort of emission like a pulsar, and we can pinpoint the magnetic field and the rotation period of the object by to explain the X-ray luminosity. This is optical and infrared data. This, from this, points are data, and this is a very simple model, this one, based on the Lyapunov-Pashinsky model, very similar to the Lyapunov-Pashinsky model to explain this. This is an equation of the evolution of the spell matter, which I explained in the emission in the optical, in the infrared. And then we go to the other kind of system that are these explosion of the supernova presence of a neutron star companion or black hole companion. This is what's happening here, exploding neutron star companion, and here a hydrodynamic So very, this is what we are trying to simulate. This system has different scales. One is the scale of the separation. One is the scale of this region where the matter starts to accrete, to go through the gravitational potential of the neutron star companion. And then there is the scale of near the neutron star, which is where you have general relativistic effects. So you have to go to understand the system, so you have the part of the dynamics, the part of the explosion, and you have the part of physics of neutron star that you have to crash. This is a question of equilibrium in the case of rotation. For general relativity, we have to solve. You cannot do it analytically, you have to go to numerical integration of this. This is what you get at the end. This is a spherical star. This is a star with rotation, with high rotation. This is a density plane. So you get the structure of the star, you get the mass, you get the radius as a function of the rotation, as a function of central density, and you have all this information from the star. So what other half you have? Composition. This is the composition in the external layers of the neutron star. You can see that there are heavy material. This is not a heavy material that you have in the outer, in the crust of the neutron star. And this is why you have the Lyon-Wachinsky process when this matter is expelled. Then this is what you have when you have rotation. This is mass, this is equatorial radius of the star, and this is what is called mass radius relation. So this is just to show you how this is the typical radius that you have for a neutron star. So you have all this information. But this is very important. Now you go in the simulation. So you have this exploding star. This is this profile of density and the profile of velocity at time zero. Time zero for us is the time of the supernova explosion. So this matter starts to expand. Follow this law. This is from the supernova cone of the Corcoran supernova cone of Los Alamos. We get that. This works in collaboration with them. This is for the first 1D computations. We already shown that you could get on the neutron star if the period, if the binary period is of the order of 5 minutes, you could get accretion rates on the neutron star of the order of a mass, solar mass, up to a fraction of solar mass per second. This is a huge accretion rate thanks to the emission of neutrinos. So you have not only photons being observed, but in this system you have a huge emission of neutrinos. And these neutrinos are the ones which allow actually the accretion, this accretion process to happen, to continue at this very, very, very high rate, because they can easily take this energy away without interacting with the material. So this is 1D, then we went to 2D. So you have this neutron star going around. This is 2015. First 2D computation, including angular momentum transfer also in the system. Then we went finally with something like two-dimensional simulation in 2016. So here you have exploding matter at the star, here the neutron star companion, here is the accretion process already. It is the neutron star embedded in this material. Then you start the neutrino emission, and at this point you have all the properties of the neutrino emission. For the accretion rate, you have the density, the temperature of the system, then you have all the properties, temperature of the neutrino, the mean energy of the neutrino, all the fissures density, and these are the fluxes of the different neutrino species. And we actually study also that in this system you have also flavor conversion of neutrinos. So the neutrinos from one flavor going to neutrinos from another flavor. These are all details, temperature, density from our system. That's why you have neutrino emission in this part where our systems are displaying temperature, density. Our systems are located here. What this plot shows is that the main channel for the neutrino emission in our system are the electron positron pair annihilation near the neutron star. So it's accreting. Well, and when this, you can go to real. One part simulation, one part is what we observe, then you have to go all together. So this is the precursor I saw you at the beginning, the X-ray precursor in a typical light cube. It's very difficult to see it. We have few systems in which we have identified this precursor in the X-ray. We see, we think, and we simulate it. This comes in the process of accretion to the neutron star. So So in this accretion you have inflow, but you have also outflows in the system. And these outflows emit in X-rays. And what you have seen is that the evolution of this outflow, this kind of spray the data, this is what you see here. Okay, this is what you see. And then we have seen this in, I put here some system, this is 09-06-18, this is here, this is 09-06-18. We have both two additional systems where we have seen this precursor, and this is, you see, this is your source, your new source of August, of July, at the beginning of August, end of July, where we identify also this kind of precursor. And there are other two sources where we identify this precursor. Later in the mission, in the gamma rays, the thing is called when the neutron star collapses from the black hole, and there is electron-positron pair formation, and then there is the process that will be described by Shesheng, and then there are all the additional properties that we need to explain this thing. From the neutron star, the binding energy, how the accretion process goes, so the star starts from here, then it moves, this is a stability plane of neutron star, then it moves, somewhere gaining matter and angular momentum, so there is transfer of mass and transfer of angular momentum. These black line are the static neutron stars, these are the maximally rotating neutron stars. This line here is the line for a gravitational collapse to a black hole. So by accreting, by the transfer of angular momentum and matter, the stars move and eventually they reach here and collapse. And this is what divided the families. This peak accretion rate as a function of the orbital period. Some system will collapse and will be some family of GRBs, and this is the other family of GRBs. I think when you will speak about that. We know that our system, for the most compact ones of the period of the order of 5 minutes, they do produce neutron star black hole binding. This was very nice to start 2015. Why it's so nice? Because actually, most of binaries, after the supernova explosion, usually they get disrupted. So they create just two runaway stars because of the explosion and bind the system. These systems are so compact, and because of the accretion process and the interaction of the binary, we show by numerical simulation that actually they keep bound, or most of them. So actually, the neutron star collapses from a black hole, you scrape, you need the GRB, the system keeps bound as a binary. So actually they are sources of neutron star black hole binaries. And this is the kind of system I showed at the beginning, the explosion. This is at the moment of gravitational collapse for a system of binary period of 5 minutes. This is for 50 minutes. Here there is no gravitational collapse of the neutron star. Here is the neutron star form at the center of the supernova. Here is the new black hole form. What you see here, what is very important for us, is that you remember the previous flow. At the beginning, the supernova is spherically symmetric, expanding the same velocity in all directions. What happens here after the interaction with the binary companion? There is not anymore spherical symmetry of the ejecta. And this is very important for the signature in gamma ray pulse. So this is what we show. This is one of the effects that we show already in our work in 2016. Thanks to these asymmetries, then you could explain some features in the Likert. This is an example of what GRB is, CO2-18. And so this matter is when, in this case, this was a system which there was not collapse to a black hole, but in the accretion process, then you need some energy, you have the outflows also emitting, and they go also into the supernova ejecta, and they travel inside these different angles, and they travel different distances and interact with different amount of matter, and they produce different kind of emission. This is an X-ray, X-ray light cube, when this light at the end goes out. This is optical luminosity. This is the optical luminosity produced by our system, how it fits with the peaks observed in the optical. This is a two-dimensional picture of our binary. You see how from the spherically symmetric case, now we have the Chinese fortune cookie geometry, what we call the Chinese fortune cookie geometry. The hole of low density hole cavity formed by the accreting neutron star. And this is important for the mission of the mission of energy. emission in the gamma phase, which is needs to go through a very low density matter. So it goes in this direction, in this spread like Shechen. And then you see asymmetries, if you see the amount of mass enclosed in different directions, this is direction the orbital, in the orbital plane. So when you go through the plane, you see different amount of matter. So around this direction, it escapes the gamma rays. And when you, the other, the electron-positron plasma going in the other directions encounters different amount of mass. You see here mass profiles, and they have a different emission. And a different emission was, this different emission we have shown that it is observed in form of flares. Flares in X-rays and flares in gamma rays. Is this. So you see explosion here. Some of the explosion, it goes free with very low density, escapes the positron plasma, cut with a very, very low body contamination at the end of certain gamma rays. But there is others, the explosion in the other direction, which comes through high density matter and is observed for peaks in the X-rays and peaks in the gamma rays, more or less 100 seconds after the ground emissions of the initial collapse. You see here different times you see in the simulation. All this is changing also because this matter is rotating. So all these effects have to be taken into account. This is a simulation. This is the plasma here exploding in this configuration. This is in real data, in real simulated data. So you see here the electron position. This is more or less, yes, because I asked David to do this. For us, yes. So this is the electron-positron plasma going into this matter. You see here, going at some distance, what you can see, maybe, is the increase of velocity near the outer part. There is an increase in the velocity when it breaks, when it goes near the surface, and this is also observed in the GRB. So with all these features we are observed. This is actually very nice work, because it is out there from one of our PhD students, is David from Argentina, to produce this kind of to study this kind of system of explosion of electron interaction of electron positron plasma with this supernova, is asymmetric supernova ejecta, to make a new library for the public called Pluto. So this is actually with a new code which will be public, soon, the new library of my biology for numerical simulation. So this is just data. These are the peaks in the X-ray flares and gamma ray flares that I just mentioned that we explain actually at this after that in the electron positron plasma going in the other direction. That then, like when this system rotates, go to in the direction of the observer sometimes after, and it's observed in X-rays and gamma. This interaction leads also to the increase of velocity of the matter at the border of the supernova ejecta. So near the outermost layer, this layer is pushed at higher velocity, near the speed of light. But this interaction with the GRB explosion. This is also new. This is what we call actually the transition from a supernova into a hypernova. And this was shown in this kind of images. And this is just the result of the latest simulations. This is the work of the people you were shown when you. This is your, these are the, your two sources. These are the videos of the simulation of your source. Okay? So this is what the source for. This is the in which the system collapses to a black hole. This is the system which there is no collapse to a black hole. So this is density diagram. This is the neutron star accreting, actually both are accreting, this accretes more. And this is the system which accretes less. This is the worst more quietly. These are the two systems studied by one really well. We have the two predictions, this is just summaries of the simulation where you see just all this asymmetry, where you see the vortices, you form an accretion disk. Actually, here rotation profiles of the particles near the neutron star. And you can see here almost a Keplerian disk at some distances of the neutron star. This is where you see vortices here. This actually is better if you show the velocity field. And you see the velocity field, for example, here. You see very well how the particles are moving near the accretion, the accreting object. Also, you can see from this picture, so this is here, this is from the top, and then you see very clear the accretion disk of the accreting star. Then you see this is the clear fortune, Chinese fortune cookie. Object for some of the simulations. This is just accretion as a function of time, how it looks at the peak. It has some different behavior as a function of different orbital periods. This is why this is so important. Evolution in time, the period is not the same, the orbital period, the distance is not kept constant because the evolution, because if the system is losing mass, it becomes wider, can cause actually also short. This is the dimensional view from this latest simulation, and this is actually what we are using now. Our asymmetries are very important, and this will be very shown. It will be shown by Rahim the relevance of this structure in the understanding of the GV emission. How well is this important? This matter, this structure of matter around the form platform, is important. Actually, very very. And how the simulation is exactly the right behavior of the emission as observed in the simulation. This is the final note. It's just to introduce you one lecture. But we will show the two kinds, these two kinds of binary collision happen now in one form black hole, one in which you don't form black hole by attrition. These are two different simulations in which actually I mentioned in the beginning, we test for the first time angular momentum conservation and the rotation period of this star here. So not only this star is important.